the house, our house is really having a hard time.
Honestly, ours stays pretty cool, but why? I have the boys keeping all the lights on, we got the fans
going. Yeah, we keep the house closed. Oh no.
And then my Suburban, the AC doesn't work at all.
So it's good to come back in.
That was just about perfect timing. Yeah, your mic should be there somewhere.
Okay.
Y'all, if y'all keep your colors, it makes it easier for the old sound guy.
Test, test.
Can you hear me up there? Yep. Welcome to Jerusalem Community Baptist Church for Sunday night services. We're glad you're joining us online. And those of you that are... What it was. It may have been mine. Can you not hear me up there? That's what I thought. It's mine.
Try this. Or use mine. Sorry, everybody. Okay, you might. You got to sit in the front. I'll switch cameras.
Okay, one, two. I'm not getting anything, huh?
There's a lot of noise that's going through.
Hello. Well, I'll tell you, it is. Okay, so it wasn't coming through the monitor.
Okay.
It's coming through the main now. We're sorry, those of you who are trying to listen to this.
This gives us time to get up to the front. Girls, the choir.
Okay, well, you girls going up there, and we'll have us a word of prayer. Do
okay.
What?
I said use my cordless one.
I will.
You might try it. Okay. We're so excited about singing songs tonight. Okay. I don't know. I think the heat has gotten to the microphones.
Yeah, I wish it was the heat. Okay, I'm turning the new one completely off.
You
did turned anybody the what? Have a new mic?
We have a new mic?
Without, does anybody, is anybody using one without the windscreen?
No.
Somebody is.
Oh.
Okay,
Mina
you'll
does.
Probably want to trade that because it's dead now.
Uh-oh.
Aww. Here's your yellow one.
Aww.
I promised to turn mine on today. Now. I didn't do it this morning.
Let's see if that does.
You didn't have it on?
I didn't have it on. I didn't notice until after we finished. I didn't say no.
Test, test. I could hear you, but nobody else.
I know.
Oh.
Oh.
It's always something. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you for the word that you put on heart tonight. We come before you, Lord, seeking your wisdom. Lord, we're praying that you give us clarity of mind and open eyes to look into your word and see what's on the surface is the same as what's deep. But Lord, we've seen the surface so strange for so long. We lift our voices to you in praise and in song. And Holy Spirit, we welcome you here. Conform us into the image of Christ. Let us experience you in spirit before we go home. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You know, we need to have a mic back here in the back because the Baptist... Oh, should we stand up? Okay. The baptistry, you can hear that water going like crazy. It just sounds so peaceful, doesn't it?
It
sounds like a waterfall. It's just beautiful. Okay, we're going to sing two songs tonight. The first one's on page 148. He keeps me singing.
And which verses are we singing?
Oh, we're going to sing one, two, and five. Yep. One, two, good, very good, because I probably would have just kept on going. And the other one's 588. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still. In all life's ebb and flow. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife, discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Verse 5.
Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Amen. Now page 588. It's supposed to already be marked. Gives you time to get to it, too. Page 588, and it's called Sanctuary. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, honor God with your body. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20.
Amen.
Page 588.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Y'all may be seated. I'd like to say that. I made me a cup of coffee. I'll be back there in a second. So.
That pretty funny. I know. I don't know how you can drink it tonight. Give me some good old tea. Yeah. Amen. That little noise, that's good. That makes me proud. Made Beverly cold this morning, so she wore a sweater tonight. Oh.
The way it is outside, it don't take much.
It does not. Yeah.
What did she say? We're going to have to use a mic, because otherwise Delbert and Flo can't hear, and probably Mina is
probably... No, I was saying that the boys were complaining it was hot earlier, and I told them we needed to be a little more thankful, because hell's hotter.
Yeah, amen.
Be always thankful. We don't have to worry about that. That reference in that song in 1 Corinthians 6... where he says, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. That whole passage, what I want to talk about tonight, and that some of that just plays in, because verse 19, what, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? If you couldn't tell this morning, I've been a little troubled by some of the things that God just keeps opening my eyes to. And we talked about this a little bit Wednesday and last Sunday, about how somehow or another this has become... Well, think of what many people will call it. They'd say the Bible is a great book of inspiration. That's not what this is. This is the living word of God, and it's our instruction book. It's not an inspiration. It's inspiring. I mean, I can see how it could fall under that, but it can't be reduced. When Paul says here in 1 Corinthians 9:19 or 6:19, when he says, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? It's like he's talking to us. Hey, do you not realize? Do you not understand that thing that you... What's the matter? Oh, it's okay, honey. I'm sorry. Which one? This one? Is it turned on? He says... Nothing's wanting to work tonight. We're just having another one of those nights, and it's not the heat, because it's not bad in here. No, it's on.
Really?
Yeah. There you go. Sometimes you just gotta hold it down. Yeah. That's all right. Now, when you think about him saying... I love to leave the King James alone when I'm reading it, when I'm quoting it, and when I'm sharing it with somebody. When we're talking about it, I like to put it in how, if I were Paul and I were telling you, or if you were Paul and you were telling me. So, what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? It's like, hey, don't you understand that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? Okay, now think for a minute. That is a powerful, huge statement. Yet I've read it over all my life. And remember, your body's temple of the Holy Ghost. Be careful what you do with it and be careful what you say. That's how we've always looked at it. And we've said it with a certain amount of reverence. I mean, he was talking, for crying out loud, about sexual sin and fornication. He says, is it proper for me to take parts and members of the body of Christ and join them with a prostitute? He says, of course it's not. Because your body's not your own. It's the temple of the Holy Spirit. Well, what he's wanting to point out here, this is that indwelling that it goes back to 2 Corinthians, goes forward to 2 Corinthians 4:8, when he says, the body is just an earthen vessel. This is, you see, if you put all of this together and you look back on what's been told us, Jesus said, you got to deny self, take up your cross daily, die to self every day, and make, this is just beyond our thinking, and yet it's what they did in here. What all of this is about is I'm coming to a harsh reality, and I don't know if everybody's going to accept this or not. I pray that God will give you eyes to see what you need to see, as he's doing with me. But the harsh reality that I'm coming to is seeing that the church right now, the church as a body, in at least in our region and in America, it appears, is extremely weak and absolutely harmless and easily influenced politically, socially. And I'm not here to drag it down and to bad mouth it at all. I'm here because I believe that God is saying, do something. Do something about Jesus. When he wrote the letters to the churches in Revelation, that's exactly what he was saying. He was basically saying, some 30 years after he left, hey, look at this. I think that if he wrote the letters today, he would say the candlestick has already been removed. And all this whole book is a book of revival and restoration and remnant, and that's us. And I believe that he's calling us. If you look around, who would have ever dreamed that we would have high-ranking politicians who are obviously men saying, I'm a woman, and then get elected and be... We would have thought, that'll never happen in America. To think that our children are being taught some of the things they're being taught sexually, and that they're trying to push even more in our school, we would have thought, no way. Romans 5:20, where he said, where sin does abound, grace does much more abound. It's time for the church to start doing what the church has not done before. And that's find out who we are, and at whatever cost, those who are willing, according to the Word of God, to become what he's called us to be. Something's got to fight this back. And it's only going to... Ephesians 6, we got to go back to that. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. You see, here's the line where the church has failed so many times, all through history of what's called the church. And like I was saying last week, I don't believe that what history and seminaries and Bible colleges and secular history are preaching has been the church all through these years. I don't believe that was the church at all. I believe the church was unseen for the most part. And the church was underground and hidden and being persecuted, or the church was just so unaccepted that they went on about their business and lived out. Our great-grandparents, our aunts and uncles, that were godly as they could be, but they were laypersons. But they knew there was God. And you've heard of the one standing out in the barn talking to God, screaming at him in the night, and they lost his mind. But somehow or another had family saved years and years and years after he died. That's been the church. Just this morning, as I was reading that about young Josiah, when they found that book and brought it to him, and he was so broken up to realize we're this far off the track. And so he looks at his prophet and his high priest, and he says, go find out from the Lord what we need to do. And they're like, we haven't heard from God in 22 years. You know, they didn't say that, but that's basically what did they do? They had to go find a woman who was in care of the wardrobe. Did you read on about that? Did you see that? That's what her job was. She cared for, and it wasn't even the royal wardrobe. She just had a job in town, and she cared for the wardrobe. She took care of people's clothing. But she was a church. She had a hold of God, and somehow or another, they knew it. And they said, well, we better go ask her. A player that wasn't even in the story. And they had to go find her. And they went and found her, and God spoke to her just like he would. She was the church. Josiah was the great leader, anointed of God, put in place, turned his heart and all this. He's on this level over here. Us, she's on this level over here. And he walks with me. Here's Josiah. I'm seeking him with my whole heart. We're doing away with sin. We're going to get this right one way or another. I'm not sure what it is. I'm a bull in a china closet, and I'm going to clean this mess up one way or another. That's got its virtue. But over here, while all hell's breaking loose, she's got family going into the house of Baal. They're worshiping false gods and all this. And she's out early in the morning saying, he walks with me and he talks. And so when it's time to hear from God, they all go to her house. Isn't that cool? I want to be that. I want to be both. I would love to be one used to instigate revival, but that's beyond me. I'm 63 and I've had my time in the limelight. I just want to know that I'm hearing him, and I want to know that we're seeing a remnant raise up, a people of prayer. As God teaches us, this is war. This is war that could be literally, quite literally, the war that we're seeing looming. Guys, this could easily be the very war that ushers in Armageddon. We could see the tribulation if it's not a pre-trib rapture. We don't know. And people that tell you they do, just wink at them. Keep listening. They may be interesting to hear. They may be right. We don't know. But I certainly am not putting my eggs in that basket. I'm keeping my eggs right here. I'm keeping y'all's eggs right here. I don't have no eggs. But I say that because what will undoubtedly be the unequivocal, most horrid war of all time could be right on the brink in front of us. And do you know what the most virtuous, most powerful thing is that any one of us can do if that war actually breaks into the physical and we're here among it? It's lay our life down for it. In love, the opportunity of martyrdom. Now, I'm not going to go off on that and turn the whole thing morbid and get everybody's skin crawling. But that's that. As you read through this and you read passages like Philippians 3, where he says, I want to know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. And when he talks about that, that's what he's trying to teach us for today. But what we need to know, what we need to be prepared for, guys, trust me, I have been completely set at ease on this whole martyrdom thing and suffering. If we get right what God is calling us to right now, seeking him, walking in the Spirit, learning to pray, and having, here's the term that the Lord just gave me about 4 years ago, and we learn to have militant love. Our love is so forceful that even the people that hate us and want to destroy us can't put their finger on what just bugs me about them. It's our love. They can't fight it. That's our weapon. That's the weapon that we'll fight with. And we'll know that we're doing it right when we're seeing things happen. We're seeing strongholds go down, and we're loving deeper and deeper. And we're caring more and more for the wicked and the sorry. We don't know which ones are Sauls of Tarsus that are about to be converted. We don't know. Y'all know as well as I do that it's easy to self-justify really getting sideways about some people because they're wicked. I mean, I'll just make it easy for you. A child molester. That's not Christ. That's not John. We never condone the sin, anything, abortion, molestation, perversion. We don't. But the people We are so self-righteous by nature, just our human, our old flesh is so conceited and ungodly and uncontrollably self-righteous. Because that 35-year-old man that's abusing a child, just 20 years earlier when he was 15, there was a church probably praying for him and really praying for him. And 8 years before that, there were a bunch of little old ladies in churches praying for him because he was being abused by his daddy or he was being beaten. But we come to a certain point where that's it, done with you. They ought to castrate you, throw you in jail, and string you up. That's not going to be how we win this battle. I'm telling you, it goes sideways with us because we want to justify the certain people that we want to see God's vengeance poured out on. We can't do that. That's not who we are. Remember when, I love this story. I was just, it's in Luke. I think it's Luke 11. Jesus is heading to Samaria. Or he's headed to Jerusalem, but he had to go through Samaria. And, in the path through the process. Oh, I thought I had it all marked up. You'll remember the story when I tell you, and somebody may find it while I'm talking. But he was going through Samaria to get to Jerusalem. And so he sends some of the disciples on ahead of him, and they go in, and the people don't receive Jesus. They didn't want him. They said, "We don't want him coming through here. He's not coming to see us. He's just going through to get to Jerusalem." And so they didn't receive him. And Peter and James, his confidants, came back to Jesus and they said, "Shall we call down fire from heaven on them, Lord?" Remember that? That's us when we see a child molester or a rapist. Or he said, "You don't know what spirit you're of. Son of Man didn't come to destroy life. He came to restore life." Did anybody find that? Well, you've all heard it. You know it's there. I thought I was in Luke 11 when I read that. Yeah. He said. Okay. Well, let's get on with what we're saying. But what we're looking at, when I was talking a while ago about some of the, you don't have to look very far into the news and stuff to see things that are just outrageous. That we would have said 20 years ago, well, we literally, some of us at our age now, we can't believe things that are happening. That is how radical the enemy is in our face. Because here's what's happened. This spirit of darkness that Paul talked about in 2 Thessalonians 2 over there when he's describing the Antichrist, and he says he's already at work. When he describes him, 2 Thessalonians 2, he says in verse 7, he says, "For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who's holding him back, or he who letteth, will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and to destroy with the brightness of his coming." But it says the spirit of iniquity is already at work. 7:1, that's the spirit of lawlessness. The hidden truth of lawlessness. How do you like that? Here's the funny thing. Right, that's 2 Thessalonians 2:7. My King James translates the mystery of iniquity as the hidden truth of lawlessness. Isn't that interesting? And here's why I find that so interesting. Girls, especially, since there's so many girls in here. Picture the brazen woman who's cheating on her best friend with her husband, and she's the one that takes her gifts for her birthday and tries to buy her the nicest gift and takes her cheating, sleeping with her husband and doing that right in her face. That's what this hidden truth of lawlessness is doing to the church today. It's like we're being taunted. The devil is right up in our face, And the church is hollering and screaming and carrying signs and telling everybody how to vote. And he's just laughing in our face and changing laws left and right and turning the whole policy of our nation upside down while we're screaming at him in the flesh. We've got to get smart. Somebody has got to. And I believe that God is calling us to open up our eyes and become obedient. And I'm telling you, if you hear this, and we'll be talking about it for some time, but as we step into this, you're going to find your whole life will change. Everything's going to change. And I can tell you this, once you get in there a little ways, you'll never consider going back. If you just look at it from the outside, you'll be, I don't know. That's why Jesus said over and over, count the cost. We just don't do that anymore. We jump right in and tell everybody, go get saved, become a part of this. This is our body becomes the temple of the Holy Ghost. Go back to that. That is a phenomenon. That's a mystery that cannot be described. That means literally what I've talked about so many times about going to Walmart and stuff like that. You're taking the holiness of Almighty God from aisle to aisle to aisle. If you just keep your mind stayed on God and believe that, you'll find that the presence of God will show up in that store, because that's the power that he's delegated to us. It's authority. It's his power, but he's delegated that authority to us. But it's not an on-again, off-again thing. It becomes, it's a dedication. Like any good parent whose son is learning to drive, he'll take him, let him drive a little bit, drive the old car, drive him around, let him learn a little bit. He's not just going to throw him the keys to the expensive, nicest ride the family had and say, go out and have fun. You walk your way into it. And as he sees, he's understanding, sees that he's getting it, and God will continue to open up spiritual gifts on us, to bless us with the fruit of the Spirit. We'll see it taking place. But it doesn't happen in the life that we've known all along. It happens when we start to understand that now this thing that I shower each day, this thing that I brush the teeth on, this thing that I put the food into, is not mine anymore. That's craziness. But it's Romans 12:1, where he said, I plead with you. By the mercy of God, I plead with you. Present your body. How else are you going to have it become the temple of the Holy Spirit unless you present it? And he said, present it holy and acceptable. Stop smoking, stop drinking, stop cussing. That's law. I don't care what you call it. Present your body holy and acceptable. Stop doing things you oughtn't do.
Isn't that the song we just sang, the sanctuary?
That's where, helped me out with the scriptural reference of the 1 Corinthians 6.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Because I'm wanting to sing it.
He told us in, I think it's, Philippians 2:12, he says, wherefore, my beloved, as you've always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. What he's talking about, I want to live a life above reproach. Now, here's the whole deal, and this is some of the things that's been twisted where people say, you don't do it by works. You don't do it by works. Works are so very important. Read the book of James. They will not get you into heaven. You can do everything right and work your whole life and fall off into hell. You can truly get saved and still stumble and get drunk and sleep in a ditch and foul up your whole life and die and go to heaven. That's a mystery of grace. But if you want to know the fullness of the promise, when you receive the grace, you naturally have a desire in you to be like Jesus. And Jesus don't smoke and chew and cuss and raise Cain. And he gives us a life example. And as we do that, John 14:21, he manifests himself to us. That's that verse I love so much where he says, if you love me, keep my commandments. His commandments, he says, it was John who said that they're not grievous. They're not grievous, but they're profitable. And they are, but some of the things, they're extremely hard in the flesh. It goes back to the loving the wicked people. But you've got to understand, and you know this, but just to touch on some of these things, somebody that's actively involved in wickedness and they're harmful and they're mean to other people, It doesn't mean you cater to them. You can't be codependent. You can't do things to keep them going in it. But you keep your heart. Sometimes it's keep away from them. It has to be. Especially your old friends with the old ways of living and the old party. But I love them. I want to bring them to the cross. No, you keep yourself getting closer and closer to Christ and praying for them and loving them with your whole heart. And never let them off your heart if you really love them that much. But stay away from them until you grow legs, and then you'll find a partner in Christ. And the two of you or the three of you can start to visit them and see if they even want you around anymore. He's been doing this a whole lot longer than any of us have. And he knows what he's doing, but greater is he who's in us. Guys, we're equipped for everything I'm talking about. And I'm going to trust that a whole lot of what's going to be revealed to us about this whole walk, God's going to reveal to you. If you take an interest and you spend time in the Word and in your prayer through the week, when we come together, we're all going to see a little bit more and a little bit more. Just because we have paved roads and gasoline engines doesn't change anything. We're still followers of Jesus Christ, just like Simon Peter and Andrew and James and John and all of those guys. There's no difference except we're living in a modern world. They had to come to a realization, and we talk about this all the time, and we say it all the time, and I'm not preaching. I'm talking myself, and I'm sharing my heart. But the 2 Corinthians 5:17, we talk about it all the time. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Well, that's the easy part. Take the next part. Old things are gone. My old music, my old way of life, my old habits, You know what? Look up the word entertainment sometime. Look at the old root of the word and look up entertainment. It's to hold. It's to hold something in. When you entertain guests, you want to keep them. You want to keep them and make them where they don't want to do anything else. You're making them at home. You entertain them. I don't want to be entertained by anybody but Jesus anymore. I'm sick of being entertained, because a lot of the things that entertain you will imprison you. Think about it. You think you're not imprisoned when you're going to spend $800 to watch a ball game? You know, that would feed some families for nearly a year, or until the last couple of months. Might feed them for a week. Entertainment. Not our friend. Why do I need to be entertained? I'm a son of God. I want to get my eyes. Colossians 3. 1. Finally, my brethren, and that's Philippians. If you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things of the earth. The beauty and the thing that I want to keep coming back to on this is what I have been just, as Sally can tell you, a lot of times I just walk around in a funk, almost in a fog, because there's an extreme heaviness, and yet there's an extreme determination. I go for walks, and I wind up walking 4.5, 5 miles, going out for a 3-mile walk, and I get alone with the Lord, and I do that same thing in the morning, and I sit there for 1.5 hours or so, and I'm seeking Him, and I keep seeing these things, and He keeps drawing me, and He's drawing me, and there's still not a whole lot that I'm seeing happen, but it's just like George and I were talking about. You come to the end of a year or 6 months, and you look back, and you say, wow. I can't see the limbs growing, and I can't see the leaves starting to green up, but I know what's happening. And here's the thing, what Sally and I are experiencing more and more as we're pursuing this. I want to be a first century Christian. God doesn't change. Why should the church have changed? The church is part of God. The church hasn't changed. I got news. The organized church has way too much. We have homosexuals leading churches now, major denominations. That has nothing to do with this. And I'm not picking on any one thing. I'm telling you, when you take something that is black and white and it tells you this, you can't even get into the kingdom of heaven. And then you put leadership in it. But what God is showing, the more we look into these things and what God is calling us into, and the purpose is spirit warfare. And the purpose is representing Christ here on earth. Jesus came, if you remember his mission, and this is the mission that passed on to us. The mission he came with was to free the captives, bind up the brokenhearted, and heal the sick. Those are supposed to be our jobs. We can't do that. George and I were talking about praying over his back soon and pray for a healing there. We should be having those kind of things happen. Look at Mark 16. I'm going to show you something that this just blows me away. And you talk to a pastor who's been to seminary, and they'll tell you the same thing. He says in verse 17, Mark 16:17, it says, "And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it will not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." Now some of you will notice in your Bible, depends on the translation, some of you may have a translation that verse isn't there. And in many of the translations, it'll say that that's not found in some manuscripts. Isn't that interesting? The church found a way to take that out of a lot of the early Bibles because they couldn't do it. That should stir something. It's clearly here. Well, some manuscripts didn't have it, and they chose not to put it in there. It wound up in my old King James. It was in the original first King James as it came out. But as time went on, they looked through manuscripts, and they said, "This is hard. This is hard. If we put this in here, none of the churches are right. None of them can do it." Then go back to the drawing board. You see, that's what man does. When you work on something and you get so invested in it, and then you get to a certain point and you say, "This part doesn't fit." We're not going back and rebuilding all. We've built all of this and this part doesn't fit. Throw that part out and keep going. That's not how this is built. That's hard. But there's a whole lot of hard scriptures in there. There's another one in 1 John chapter 5. I don't know if you've heard some people that will, they'll deny the Trinity. They'll say that they'll say the Trinity is never taught in the Bible. It's never talked about in the Bible. And yet, in 1 John 5, 5 or 4, five, seven. "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one." Look at different translations, and they'll say that's not in the original transcript, so they took it out of most of the translations of the Bible. Not in there. 1 John 5, 7 is not in a lot of translations of the Bible. So does everybody have that here? What version do you have? Anybody got a Living or a NIV or a, what you got in there, Pat?
We have these three witnesses, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and all three signs.
Okay, so it took the one out about the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Because see, in here, in the King James, it reads, that covers 7 and 8. That just skipped 7 and made 8, 7. In this one, it says, verse 7, "For there are three that bear record in heaven." Three bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Then verse 8, "And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree in one." They just take 7 out. and go right over it. See, I hope you hear my heart. Jesus, the first thing he told the disciples when they said, give us the signs of your coming, what's going to happen? He said, don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. When we started this road nearly 9 years ago, when I started really getting this hunger for the Word, I was in a New Living Bible. And I still like the New Living Translation. It's good. And my cousin Marvin, who's on the Zoom meetings a lot, he'd, King James, you better stick with that King James. You better stick with that King James. You just like a bunch of these and thous. You don't know what you're talking about. And I'd tease him and go on and on about it. And I'd talk about how when Ahab, I'd tease him because I know everything. And I have my New Living Translation. And I'd tease him about how when the king of Syria came and said he was going to, told Ahab, give me all of your gold and your silver and your women and your children. And he was afraid of battle, so he gave them. And then the next day, he comes back and he says, now we're going to come and we're going to go through everybody's tent and we're going to take everything else we want. He couldn't go that far. So he tells the elders of the land, and the elders say, give him nothing. We'll go back before the Lord. You tell him that we're not going to do that. So he sends a message back to this king of Syria, and he says, we've done everything you ask. We've given you, but this is unreasonable. We can't do this. Well, the king of Syria says, by this time tomorrow, there won't be any way to even count the dust left of Jerusalem. We'll wipe you out till there won't be anything even left of the dust. And here's what Ahab said. Let not him that putteth on the armor boasteth like him that taketh the armor off. And I'd tease Marvin with that. I'd say, what's that supposed to mean? I can read it to you in a New Living and you'll know, but what's that supposed to mean? Let not him boasteth that putteth on the armor like him that taketh the armor off. Well, now that the Spirit's in me, I understand exactly what old Ahab was saying. You can talk big putting that uniform on, but let's see if you live to take it off tomorrow night. Don't be so cocky. But I teased him about it. And then when the Lord started moving on my heart about the Word of God, and this isn't a King James message that I'm trying to make here, but it will tell you where I come from, the way I do. Sally and I, when we met, we both were fans of the New American Standard. Great Bible. Great Bible. But what I've come to realize, you find an old translation. When this first happened, when God first said, okay, we're going to put Scripture in English now. At first, it was in Latin, the first one. I think that the Greek and the Hebrew were first made over into a Latin. It made several rounds before it came to English. When it came to English, King James was commissioned. He commissioned a bunch of monks to do this translation about the same time the Geneva Bible was translated, but they're almost identical. And this goes back to 1611. This was the first one God gave us. So it may be hard for me to understand in some ways, but the author lives in me. And I'll always say, when I read it in here, don't tell me this wasn't in the original manuscripts, because this came back to the first ones that we had. I'm ignorant. I've never been to Bible college, never been to seminary, but it's working for me just real good. And I'm not backing off of that. Okay, a few years later, and it's understandable, for academia's sake, some people, I think the best first one was the International Version. And they came and they took the Hebrew and the Greek texts, and they went through them, and they made a great translation, the International Version. And then they did the American Standard. These were years ago, back in the 50s and 60s, and they did these translations. And what it was scholars and people that loved God and people that were really seeking the Lord and wanted to get the Word of God understood by the more uneducated people and try to get it out there. Well, that started getting popular. And next thing you know, and we don't know where the line is, you have to be real careful. Next thing you know, agendas start going into it. Until the New International Version takes out gender reference. How do you like that for political correctness? And it doesn't refer to the disciples or any people like that as he, or they were always they. Didn't refer to he and she and such as that. And some of them, they take references to homosexuality out of the Bible. So just be wise on things like that. But as far as coming to the Word of God, always keep you a King James or an old version of a New American Standard or an old NIV. The old NIV in 1984 is a really good Bible. But when you read it, and Sally and I have been telling you this since we started this church, when you read your Bible, don't fail to say, Lord, speak to me as I read this. Make this come alive in my heart and show me what you want me to hear. Because when you read things like your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, we could chew on that the rest of this week. We could take that and chew on that all week long and come to realize, how am I dressing? Where am I going? Sometimes, I'll go ahead and say some of this. You'll find as you go further and further, you'll think, I don't need to be doing this. Don't get this too wrong. This is a little bit too cushy for me. Why do I think I need this? It's enough I have an air conditioner. I have some water and I can take a shower. Why do I have to have this? That's just the thinking. I'm not telling you to start thinking that way to get closer. I'm telling you, would you start to get closer? This is a funny thing. When we first, just before we started this church, Sal and I were barely paying our bills. And since then, God has opened up a few extra incomes for us. But the first thing that he did before he started opening up the incomes for us with the USRN, and we both now draw on Social Security. Hallelujah. You're going to like that, George. But the first, yeah, you got a long way, we know. But the thing God did before he started bringing these little increments was he started taking our wants. And I can't tell you how that pleased me. I used to be the one that my whole desire, my whole life was a new Corvette. I always wanted to own a new Corvette. Whatever year, I want to get a brand new one. And now I see them going down the other side on the freeway when I'm driving. I'm like, that person is sitting in emptiness and vanity. Several thousands of dollars worth of emptiness and vanity. There's no substance. There's no substance to the things that we waste and put our attention to. They're all diversions. And I'm telling you, God will clean you up in so many ways you have no idea. If you move toward this, and I'm praying that we'll all move together. I see a hunger in so many eyes here to be able to, I want to make a difference. When I watch, those of y'all that remember us on the radio, when we found a fight, we'd fight it. Whether it was a district attorney or whether it was a business that was doing somebody wrong or whatever, we'd love to fight. That's who God made me to be, but he turned it around now. And I don't want to make trouble in public at all. I'll go down and look defeated in front of everybody. Doesn't matter to me anymore. But I'll tell you, in my spirit, I'm ready to fight this. And I want a family, I want a church family to fight it too. I'm sick of watching, I don't want to say it because we're online tonight, but right here in this congregation, a couple being rebattled on drugs and promiscuity and just dragged back in by the very enemy that we have under our heel. But we don't know how to do anything about it. Does that not stir anything in some of you guys? I know it does, y'all, because of what you're finding at home. And I know that most of us have loved ones that are just under the devil's thumb. I'm sick of it. And I'm learning. Let's go back just before we start to wind out to Ephesians 6. We've spent a lot of time there, and sometimes I think we ought to just pitch a tent. Because he's given all these beautiful instructions on family and how to live at home and how to live with your masters. And he's even talking about masters. If you're slaves or you're working for somebody that's a wicked boss and whatever, he said, just keep on working. Just keep on working. How they treat you, they'll answer to you. Just keep working under me. Can you imagine that? He's talking to people who were slaves their whole existence, the Jews. You know, they said, we never served any man. But anyway, after he teaches all that, he comes to verse 10, he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That needs to raise something up in each one of us. Mina, you're a warrior. You're a warrior. Eddie, you're a warrior. You've known that in your flesh your whole life, but in your spirit, God's made you who you are so that these things coming against your kids and coming against other people in this community, we're the ones that can stand up if we'll just learn how to do it. If we'll just learn how to not keep thinking we've got to, this is getting old and deteriorating. It's coming a time it's not going to do us any good. But 2 Corinthians 4:18, Paul said, though the outer man perish, the inner man's renewed day by day. That tells me when I'm 93 and I barely get around, I'll be knocking devils off stools everywhere I go. Oh, hallelujah, I hope that's so. I'm sure it was with John on the Isle of Patmos. He says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. They think he was, 91. I think it's what it says. He was about 91 years old on the Isle of Patmos. And he got in the Spirit on the Lord's Day. I bet there wasn't a devil within a half a mile. I bet you're all cleared out when he's receiving that vision. When that vision starts in on him, I bet the whole island was. Remember when Saul was converted? Said they all heard voices. They didn't know what it was, and they were all trembling. And when Daniel received that vision in chapter 9, it says they heard things, but they were all down on their knees. They were all scared to death. They didn't know what was going on. Daniel's talking to God. That's why we have it. It's us. That's us, Pat. There's no difference. There's not any difference if we'll learn that we're called to this. He says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. Why would he talk about tangible things here? To get it through our skulls. He's trying to make it where we can understand. Put on that whole armor of God so that you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Most of us have not experienced the wiles of the devil. We've experienced hard times. We've experienced trials. We've had issues come up. Sometimes if you start really doing good, the devil will throw some snares out. If you want to experience some wiles of the devil, let God prepare you. When you become a threat, then you'll experience some of the wiles of the devil. What an honor. That's when you'll learn to wear that armor too. The wiles of the devil. Because verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Our goal and our job is to love flesh and blood. Well, where was I yesterday? I was in Walmart. Silly question. And walking around in Walmart, and as I'm seeking God and I'm worshiping, and I'm just looking at all these lost people and reading things on their shirts and looking at the conversations they're having. And my heart, I could just see God saying, I want them. I want them. I haven't sent Jesus back yet because I want them to have a chance to come in. And I just start praying against strongholds and praying that some of them that hadn't been to church, hadn't heard the word of God in years, God will just work something around in the family. Somebody moved out of the way. Something will happen. They'll say, let's go to church. Okay, let's go. And now hear the word. Just standing for them and realizing some of those may have been some of the rottenest, sorriest people in town. But God saw. Same thing he saw in me when I was the sorriest, rottenest people in town. What does it say? God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And God will start to turn your heart to love those people and to love them. And boy, as you do, then when you see what the devil's doing against somebody, be strong in the power of the Lord, and it'll start to raise up in you. And you'll go the other way a lot of times in your flesh while your spirit's going right into the middle of the fight. That's what we've got to learn to do. Finally, the last thing, Hebrews 4. These are all real familiar, but Hebrews back over toward the end there. You're at Thessalonians, go right. I cannot find it. There you go, 4. Very, very familiar again. Verse 12, where he says, for the word of God is quick, that's alive. The word of God is alive and powerful. That's what I'm reading to you right now. It's the spoken word, it's the written word. They're one. For the word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit, and the joints and the marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. You got to stay in the word. If you're hearing what I'm saying, ask the Lord, ramp me up again this week, Lord. Ramp it up and cause me to spend more time in your word. And cause me to want to. Make that your prayer. Lord, cause me to want more time in your word. Cause me to start reading some of these stories that the preacher keeps talking about and start reading them for myself. There's some good stuff in there. These stories are just so exciting and interesting. And you see God revealed in them. But as you do, as you read these stories and you spend more and more time in this two-edged sword, the more time you throw yourself on this two-edged sword, it'll cut right down the middle, and you'll see, I don't want to be like that anymore. Ooh, I want more of this. It separates. The spirit from the, what does it say, the soul and the spirit. The soul is your soul, man. That's, I sure do like me some tacos and soda pop. And the spirit says, I want to be around some brothers and sisters. I want the word of God. It separates it. And the joints and the marrow. The joints, always doing. The marrow, life. That's where the life of the body is. That's where the being is. I'm a child of God. I love that old Pentecostal song, I cannot be defeated and I will not quit. Boy, I wish I could sing. Neither is there any creature that's not made manifest in his sight. I love how it says his. When it says the word of God, is it describes a sword, and yet it says there's nothing that's not manifest in his sight. All things are naked and open to the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So hang on to that in Hebrews. And just I encourage you as you go into this week, as you go back home, pray about seeing who God intended you to be when he saved you. He didn't intend any of us sit on a bench. I'm convinced of that now. That's why he spent so much time. You're already in. You're already in, baby. He has purpose. He has purpose. And here's the thought I want to leave you with. The urgency that I'm feeling, the passion that I want you to have, the urgency that needs to be in there, and the radicalness that I'm even talking about is just the other side to what we're watching take away everything we ever held dear. Right in front of us. That wanton woman is right in front of us as the bride of Christ, taking everything that we find to be holy. It's happening right in front of us. So take that in your thoughts and take that in your prayers and say, Lord, I've always been a person of the flesh and I can get things done, but I'm asking you to put that aside. Teach me how to love these people that are trying to destroy our nation, and teach me how to start to take down the strongholds that you said I can take down. I think he wants it far more than we do. Amen. Anybody want to share anything or say anything on that? Yes. Yes, ma'am. Tim. Who's Tim? Oh, Tina. I thought you said Tim. We didn't get to go Thursday, and I'd sure like to see him again. That all went so quickly, and I was fascinated when I realized it was him. Okay. For what? For being sick. So Lori's not doing well, and BJ, we got to meet him in the ministry the other day. That's Beverly's grandson. Did Mitchell put the house up for sale?
Lori's house. Lori's house is up for sale. I've been helping her with it. And she's probably been working too hard, but she's
dead. Oh.
So she's going to have to move and find another place.
Did she find any work?
Well, she works at home. She has a work. And then she Donna hired her back. And her mother all of her.
Right. That's awesome. That's good. That's good for her self-esteem, too.
She cleans house for people.
Okay.
But she still has to move. She's trying to keep the kids in the district, you know, because they love school. So she's got a rough road ahead of her.
They've got you. You're a very good example, your good grandma. Boy, we're so proud to have you in this body. That's true. That's true. Anybody else? Well, let's stand and have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your call. And Lord, I ask you tonight that your Holy Spirit would move on our hearts and draw us to you, Lord. You've called us. Let us recognize now, if we have to go back 40, 50, 60 years to when you first called us, let us go back and look at that call. When you washed our sin away, and when you made us clean and whole and gave us new life, Lord, we gave you our whole life. And let us realize what that is, to take the new life and to walk in it and to be your representatives. Lord, let us not fear the darkness, and let us certainly not walk into it in the flesh and be destroyed, but let us learn to be the children of God and to hold up the royal diadem and bring glory to Jesus our Lord. It's in his name we pray. Amen. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me
now. Don't forget about in the morning we have the Zoom meeting at 7:30. So the Zoom meeting, anybody else gonna be up at 5? No. Let me see if I can figure out. So the Zoom meeting is at 7:30 in the morning, and you can see that on Zoom. So if you don't know how to get there, just go to the website, which is JerusalemCommunityBaptistChurch.com. Otherwise, we'll see you guys tomorrow night for the Bible read at 8 o'clock. Everybody pretty well that's here, except for James, is usually on the Bible read, right? Yep. Exactly, at 8 o'clock. Okay, God bless y'all, and I'm going to try and turn this all off. God bless y'all. It's good night.